mentioned the Jupyter Notebooks and the fact that they were really central to the work or the workflow of data science. So let's look at those Jupyter Notebooks closely. And first, let's start a Jupyter Notebook. So the easiest way to start a Jupyter Notebook is to have the Anaconda distribution of Python installed. And you can use the Anaconda Navigator to graphically start a Jupyter Lab or a Jupyter Notebook. Jupyter Lab is a little bit more modern, so I tend to prefer using Jupyter Lab. And all you have to do is click Launch. And what that's going to do is start a server on your machine, a kernel or server that you can then connect to. And you connect to it with a browser. So that's one of the powerful things about Jupyter is that everything is in your web browser, as you can see here on my web browser. This also means that you can have distributed version of Jupyter Lab, which are known as Jupyter Hubs, where you can collaborate and connect from multiple location on the same notebooks. To create notebooks is very simple. You just push a plus here. And then you have to choose the type of notebook you want. So we'll start by doing a Python notebook. But notice that there are multiple languages you can use with Jupyter Notebook. You're not limited to Python. In fact, there's probably over 100 computer languages you can use in a Jupyter notebook, including some of my favorite ones, Julia, Scala, Python, and Java. But for now, we'll open a Python 3 notebook. And as soon as I create a Python 3 notebook, this is what I see. I have an empty notebook called Untitled. I can rename my notebook by right-clicking on it and then choosing Rename. But really the important thing is that I can now execute code. So because this is a Python notebook, I can execute Python code. So for instance, I can create a variable and assign a number to that variable. Now to run a Jupyter Notebook cell, I need to press Shift and return at the same time. And this basically does nothing because I've assigned the value 3 to x and there is no output to this operation. But if I was to do an operation that will have an output, I can actually see that output immediately if I don't assign it to a new variable. So for instance, let's multiply x by 3. And as you can see, I obtain 9 as my output. And that's really an important concept here. If you assign that value to a variable, then you don't see the output, but it's stored in a variable that you can use later in your Jupyter notebook. Now, notebooks are not just for code. You can actually also do text with Jupyter notebook. So for instance here, if I select this cell, I can go into Markdown, and now I can write Markdown code because I changed this cell from a coding cell to a Markdown cell. So Markdown is a simple language. If I want to put a title, I can do this. And if I run it, now you see that there is text appearing on this screen. And that's one of the power of Jupyter, is that you can mix a narration, text, and explanation with the different cells. And that's something that I would encourage you to do, because then you can organize your data very nicely. And of course, in Jupyter Notebooks, you can also plot your data. So you can have graph, code, and a visual exploration of the data all on one location. And that's why they're so popular. There's a few features I want to show you on Jupyter Notebook that will make your life easier when you run with a notebook. So you already know that to execute the cell, the code in a cell, you press Shift return. But let me show you what you can also do. So let's say you have a complex notebook like this one with lots and lots of cells and you want to run them all. Then what you would do is you would go into the run menu here and you would say run selected cell, or you can run all cell, or you can also have a combination of running cells that are below or above that particular cell. So that's always very handy. And what do you do if your kernel, so the server that runs your Python code in the case of this course, stops to work? When all of a sudden you have no output, nothing works, then you have to do something. Well, the solution is to restart the kernel. Let me show you how. If you want to create a new cell below one of your cell, it's very simple. You just click on the cell and you click on that little plus here, and that creates a new cell. So you can make new code. But if you also have a cell where you've entered a lot of code, so let's imagine that here I enter more code. Let's say I will now enter this line of code, but I don't want this all in one cell. I want to split the cell. That's also very easy. You just go wherever you want to split the cell, and then you push the combination control, shift, and minus. So I'll do that right now. And as you can see now, that has created a new cell with the code that was below my insertion point. All of these little tips are very useful because as you get to become more familiar with Jupyter Notebook, you learn to be efficient and run your code very cleanly. Let's look at what happens now with the orders of the operation, how you do the operation and how it impacts your code. One thing to know about Jupyter Notebook is that everything in a notebook is accessible by every cell in that notebook. So for instance, if here I declare in this cell here below a new variable, let's say I'll declare this as my variable equals 2. In the cell above, I can use that variable, and for instance here, I can multiply it by 2. You can see the results for com. So that's one key thing here with Jupyter Notebook. You can run your code whichever way you want. You can start at the bottom, go back at the top, and rerun the things. Once you've run a cell, that result is in memory, and you can use it really anywhere in the notebook. But be cautious, because we tend to think more as linearly as a coder. It's much easier if you put your operation in order in the Jupyter Notebook. So you start at the top and then go down, create new cells, etc. There's another benefit to doing this. If you have to kill your kernel, or if you want to rerun all of your code, that running will happen sequentially from the first cell to the second cell to the third cell, etc. So if your logic is no longer linear, you're going to run into a problem. You're going to have error where you're going to try to run something with a variable that has not been defined yet because it's defined below in your code. So try always to keep your code clean. But Jupyter Notebooks are extremely powerful, and I encourage you to explore and play with them.